Welcome back to the National World War I Museum and Memorial here in Kansas City, Missouri. It is our pleasure to start the second half of our day in our fourth annual symposium, part of the Centennial Series. This year it is 1917, America Joins the Fight. And wouldn't you know it, when I put my phone onto silent, I also managed to lock it. Which is not always the best thing when you know you are mentioning partners' names and things like that. You always want to get them right, especially if they're in French. Now, the National World War I Museum and Memorial, with the World War I Centennial Commission, we produce an education newsletter that focuses on the best resources available to teachers and learners, both those that are created here, like the videos of these symposium lectures, which will later be available both on C-SPAN, but also our YouTube channel. If this is your first symposium, you can go back onto our YouTube channel and see some of our previous lectures as well. But we also focus on those really excellent educational resources of some of our partners, like the National Archives, the Mission des Centenaires, Stanford History Education Group, and our most recent newsletter addressed Americans All, and how, in our diverse nation, groups and individuals affected the war and were affected by it. Dr. Saje Mathieu, Associate Professor of History at the University of Minnesota, will be speaking to just that: African Americans and the Promise of 1917. Dr. Mathieu specializes in 20th century American and African American history with an emphasis on race, war, globalization, immigration, social movements, and political resistance. Keep your eyes peeled. She's got a new book that will be coming out, The Glory of Their Deeds, A Global History of Black Soldiers and the Great War Era. A former fellow at the Schomburg Center for Research in Black Culture, Harvard's W.E.B. Du Bois Institute, among others, she has also graced the stage of the famous Fitzgerald Theater. Thank you, Minnesota Historical Society. So please help me welcome her to our stage this afternoon, Dr. Saje Mathieu.
Good afternoon, and thank you for being here. And thank you, Laura, for that wonderful introduction. I'm new to the club, so I have to embrace the reality that I can't get as much done without them. I think most people really want glasses until they actually need them, and then it's not so fun. So my name is Saje Mathieu, as mentioned, and this afternoon I will be moving at quite the pace so that I can squeeze everything in our 45 minutes and have plenty of time for questions. I welcome them, so if they pop up as I speak, do write them down. Lafayette, we are here, African Americans and the Promise of 1917. One of the enduring myths about the Great War, both at the time and in contemporary literature, is the idea that African Americans did not, in fact, think very much about or care about World War I, or at the least, they didn't until late 1917 or 1918, and that is absolutely not true. Part of the seductive appeal of believing that African Americans just hadn't thought about the war at all fits into the notion that they were either too simple or too navel-gazing to really care about what was happening abroad. In point of fact, African Americans had been writing extensively about the Great War as early as 1914, even before the war itself breaks out. So they're already starting to keep an eye on what's happening and reporting about it extensively and regularly in the African American press. Before I move any further, I want you to remember that first and foremost, African Americans are Americans, something that we forget far too frequently. So this afternoon, I hope to hit on these main areas. First, the import of the war for African Americans, how African Americans thought about and talked about the war globally, how for them it was then a local war, this idea of a French utopia and an enrapture with France and the cost of war for African Americans. So what do I mean when I say that African Americans are first and foremost Americans? Well, like other Americans, they too wondered whether peace was a viable path. They wondered and questioned what exactly was their duty to, as Americans, but also as African Americans, did they have any actual duty in this imperial conflict between European kissing cousins? How will the war, should they support it, should we as a nation get into it, how will that war derail the civil rights work that African Americans were involved in even before 1914? So this would have included, in particular, challenges to Jim Crow laws, and by 1915, African Americans are pouring their resources, their money, their attention, their educated young people into fighting, in particular, the grandfather clause and obstructions to the vote. In addition to these questions, of course, African Americans are really consumed by the pivotal importance of Jim Crow in American life. It's important for us to remember that by the time that the Great War begins in Europe, Jim Crow, this set of laws and practices that reinforce segregation, well, Jim Crow is about 20 years old, right? So we're talking about this first generation of African American men who are born and raised under the Jim Crow's jackboot, if you will. And what then do we make of them? Is this the assessment of the race's future? The other thing that African Americans are thinking about are things like the reality that they're rounding the 300th anniversary of the first Africans' encounter with the Americas. They're thinking very carefully and writing about 50 years since the end of the Civil War, and in some respects, Reconstruction and its failed possibilities. They're talking about they're looking at the end of slavery in Puerto Rico. They're talking about, to a lesser extent, but nonetheless it's happening, the end of the war of 1812 and 1814, right? Where there too there were promises. They are especially concerned with American encroachment in the Caribbean, especially in the case of Haiti. And so they're thinking both locally and globally. And probably the thing that dominates African-American concern in this era is the spread of racialized violence. And we talk about lynching, and it's apparent, you know, in terms of how much of a problem this is, how it comes to define unfairly in many respects an entire region of the country when lynching is happening almost everywhere in the country. But the additional practice of racial terrorism that deeply concerns African Americans, in fact terrorizes them, is the bizarre, macabre, deeply disturbing practice of lighting African Americans on fire. Not just their property. So arson is a problem, but lighting black people in particular on fire. And so again, these are the kinds of things that we're talking about, and are therefore an important backdrop for how then African Americans will compare and contrast their position with what's happening in the rest of the world. Even before African Americans suited up for war, they were aware of other black people involved in the Great War, right? In particular, African soldiers who are normally referred to as tirailleurs sénégalais, regardless of where they're from, they're all gonna be called Senegalese sharpshooters. not by African Americans, but by people all over the world. And so they're concerned about them, they're concerned about black people in the Caribbean who are now, as a result of being part of the British Empire, drawn into the war, and Canadians, and I'll come back to that. These men articulating, and women articulating, these political concerns are known by a term that W.E.B. Du Bois coins, the men on your right. They're called soldiers without swords. And while this is a term that will come into greater use after the war, Nonetheless, it really captures this sense of urgency for a lot of African Americans. So yesterday, Dr. Keene talked about how African American organizations like the NAACP are in their stage of infancy at this time. It's important for us to remember that so too are African American newspapers, right? And so for these men and women who are professionally trained, college educated, usually elite college educated, the newspaper will become an important way of not only legitimizing and explaining the war, but also legitimizing and explaining their professional voices, right, as these intellectual activists, these soldiers without swords. The man on your left is Monroe Trotter, who makes everyone else seem soft. Harvard educated, unrepentant, he becomes a thorn in Woodrow Wilson's side because he holds the president's feet to the fire. He is in particular known for opposing or at least questioning the terms under which African Americans will enlist in the war, but also really coordinating an international campaign to quash the release of Birth of a Nation, the homage to the Klan that comes out in 1915. One of my favorite quotes by W.E.B. Du Bois on the war, and again, he writes this before the United States enters the war officially, and he says, "Absolute loyalty in arms and in civil duties need not for a moment lead us to abate our just complaints and just demands." So for African Americans, like other Americans, they will say against the accusation that they lack patriotism, they lack a robust understanding of a citizen's duty to their nation, he will say instead, no, it is precisely because I understand the true meaning of patriotism that I say that my country must listen to our urgent needs and must respond in exchange for our support. This is exactly what women are doing, right? And let's be clear that war is a perfect time for concessions, or at least to ask for them, because you're needed. It's true. It's totally true. Another person who is, I describe her as a little lady who packs a lot of punch, Ida B. Wells, who had in fact made the case for the urgency and the alarming practice of lynching long before her male counterparts understood this problem. But Ida B. Wells is another such journalist who is writing about the war and writing about this crisis, both moral and physical, for African Americans. Now, in the case of Wells and Du Bois in particular, though not exclusively, it's also important for us to remember that they have connections overseas, right? They went to school overseas or lectured overseas, and so they're able to tap into those alliances to find out what's happening in Europe, to find out what can, you know, what humanitarian responses might be needed, and to bring that information back to African American communities. So this next picture is of African-American journalists who are gathering at a conference in Washington, D.C., and trying to outline what will be the key issues that they press with the president. You'll notice that there are in the front row some French soldiers who are already there, and some French diplomats who were involved in this war. W.E.B. Du Bois and Monroe Trotter are right at the center of this photograph. This meeting proves so contentious. Woodrow Wilson has one of his many conniptions and decides that he will no longer have African Americans come to the White House to air their grievances. And in the man could hold a grudge because by the Versailles treaty negotiations, he also refuses to hear or have an audience with Du Bois in particular, but African Americans writ large. So my second point was this question of a global war and what does it mean for African Americans. This political cartoon captures perfectly for me how African Americans thought globally and then also used this global language to reflect back on the case of the African-American experience. So this is from the Crisis magazine. And the script that was on the bottom and too small for you to see, I just retyped, Voice of the Congo, if you only left us our hands, Albert, we could be of more use to you now. So this, to me, is very powerful because it makes clear both an interest for African Americans in these global debates, an absolute understanding of what's happening, an indictment of what was happening in the Belgian Congo before, but also a warning for Americans of what could happen here in their own time of need, right? So there are a few countries that African Americans talked about repeatedly leading up to 1917 and use these as platforms for a sublimation of their own political concerns. This, of course, in addition to a genuine humanitarian concern for these locations. So it's serving double duty. In the case of Belgium, African American intellectual activists would say that in some respects, what the Germans were doing to the Belgians was a comeuppance that was long overdue, given what Belgium had been doing, and in some respects continued to do in the Belgian Congo. And that this kind of brutal exploitation that reserved for the Congolese was the very essence of a Belgian moral and spiritual decay. And that is what awaited Americans if they did not pull back from their commitment to racialized terrorism. For many African Americans, South Africa is in a close second, right? Especially given its growing commitment to apartheid. So we see a lot of comparable editorials calling attention to the brutality that South Africans, and especially the separatists in South Africa, are starting to do in that little pocket at the bottom of Africa. Poland and Ireland are frequent guests in African American newspapers, in part because African Americans will hold on to those two countries in particular as kind of a hope for an independent, successful independent future for otherwise oppressed Europeans. And sometimes in the case of Poland, they'll even talk about how they're Europe's Negroes. So this language of an oppressed minority is especially important in the case of Poland and Ireland because there it is religious and in some instances ethnic, especially in the case of Poland. Russia is very important for African Americans prior to 1917, both because, again, the patterns of pogroms that occurred in Russia leading up to the war, and because of the revolution in 17, this then becomes a place where it seems possible to topple the impossible. So for African Americans, it will become a way of talking about what they might want to consider for themselves. And finally, the Armenian genocide, a matter that African Americans take up as early as the 1890s, maybe even a little earlier than that. I have a separate piece on that in particular, but there are so many echoes between the experiences of African Americans and Armenians, including this, you know, bizarre practice of lighting people on fire. In the case of all of these countries, African Americans pool very limited resources and create either programs or campaigns to help these imperiled Europeans. So for example, by 1917, African Americans will have a campaign to raise money to send enough baby food to take care of Belgian babies for 3 months. They will pledge by 1917 to raise $1 million for African orphans and their widows. So again, there's this constant reportage in the newspapers of what's happening to African soldiers over there. They're in artillery units, they're in machine gun units. So while the US is still debating whether African Americans should be part of the war in 1917, African Americans will say the French have been doing this and the British. now for 3 years. Why are we still talking about it? There's even a very bizarre case of a Jamaican-born turned Austrian fanatic who wins the Iron Cross for the Austrians in 1917, and he is celebrated in the African American press as, again, a possibility of what, you know, what can happen when you take Jim Crow out of the equation. So we're talking about a population that is overwhelmingly working in a cash-poor sector, right? Cotton farming. And to take the few dollars that they do get when they get them and to make the decision to spend them on, in effect, an abstract concept, African soldiers all the way over there, and to make that decision as early as 1914 is, for me, again, another way that the war is something that African Americans start to contemplate a lot earlier. And of course, African Americans will talk about the Caribbean as a cautionary tale because they believe, and Du Bois would be in that group, that the United States is in fact sort of stretching itself into the Caribbean, trying to make it yet another Deep South, under the distraction of war. So Haiti, Puerto Rico, even the Panama Canal Zone become these hotly contested racial spaces. And African Americans think that this is only the start. The attraction are the deep ports that are available in some of these islands, like the Danish West Indies, like St. Kitts, for example. But there's another problem, and that is the British, the frenemy that is the British. And at this very time, Canada was making the hard sell to Great Britain to have a Caribbean island, ideally Jamaica, given to them as a thanks for coming out with this war gift. And we nearly got Jamaica as a province, but instead got Newfoundland, no fair. But the argument made consistently, both in the press and in official military documentation, is that Canada needed its own Deep South. It needed to prove its modernity by having black people that they could control. And there's a lot of concern over what to do with the vote if we have this extra island, because we don't necessarily have a legal Jim Crow structure like the United States. So African Americans are keeping an eye in all these different spaces as the war is unfolding. One of those spaces is, of course, France, and where African Americans are joining the war before as individuals, just like other Americans, right? So here we have Eugene Bullard, who joins the Lafayette escadrilles mentioned earlier this morning. And what's important here is that African Americans are seduced by the same language of patriotic martial heroism as all other Americans, right? But in particular, because successes like Bullard's give the lie to the core promise offered by Jim Crow, by segregation. And that is that when racial lines hold, violently if necessary, blacks and their inescapable inferiority will be confirmed. So when we see Eugene Bullard here, what's dangerous about him isn't that he's an ace pilot fighting alongside Ivy Leaguers in Douce France. It's that we see this healthy body decorated with awards, the very embodiment of manliness that is not, and a cosmopolitanism that is not supposed to happen. This is an aberration, a mistake, and worse, the French are celebrating him. So this question of black men in uniform will be such a prickly one that after the war, we have an uptick in not just black veterans being singled out for attack. We know that some are even lynched in their uniforms, but there are also these small-scale attacks, spitting on them, ripping off parts of their uniforms. The Canadians are so distraught by what they see happening in the United States that they take the added precaution of requiring that their black soldiers take off their uniforms before they even board the ships in Great Britain to come back to the Americas. So again, this spreads beyond the simple American borders. Images like this would also have been problematic for many in America. These are the French cuirassiers elite cavalry, and they are working with training with African soldiers, the tirailleurs that I mentioned earlier, roughly translated as African sharpshooters. By war's end, at least 500,000 African soldiers will have served under the French flag alone. That doesn't even yet account for the British, the West Indians, the Black Canadians who also joined the armed forces. So Americans enter World War I having already thought about a Black martial experience before they reach European shores. Here we see a picture of the Canada's number 2 construction battalion, which is attached to the forestry corps. What I'd like to say about these guys is that you're not in fact looking at Canadians. What you're looking at are largely Americans. By my calculation, African Americans accounted for at least 40% of Black men serving under the Canadian flag, not that we actually had one at that time, and that doesn't even yet include descendants of African Americans who would have come as, whose ancestors came as Black loyalists, or who came during and after the War of 1812. This is also an army that has a robust representation of West Indians. The British will float them up from the Caribbean to all gather up at Halifax and then have one shipment across. From what I've seen with border charting the borders and when these men are coming, they are arriving largely from the Detroit area, but not exclusively. Many of these men are coming from Georgia, Florida, Alabama, and they're citing at the border that joining the army is a correction to unemployment. So what does this mean to me? Well, first of all, we're getting a concrete reminder that the Great Migration expanded beyond Chicago and Cleveland in the way that we normally talk about it, that these men continued seeking work wherever that work was available. And if it meant crossing borders, then they did. And crossing the border would not have been easy for Black people at this time, as Canada adopted a ban on African American immigration in particular in 1911. It didn't stay on the books for long, but it was there, and the spirit of that law never went away. So there are all of these, shady, to use current street parlance, ways of keeping these men out. What I love is that Canadians were not very good at identifying race, though they wanted to be. And so they did. And so so you see on the enlistment records all of these things like, I think he's Black, but I'm not sure. He looks sallow. And so all the different words that they use has become quite comical for me, and now I can decipher them, right? They'll describe them as yellow, they'll describe them as perhaps not well cleaned, right? So that they've, at the end of the summer, so that they've tanned and you can't really tell. I mean, my brother would fall in that category. But it points to this desire to identify race, but this inability to do it as well as the Americans. Bizarrely, once the Canadians mandate and that everyone must serve, then they actually send headhunters down into the United States to bring back Canadians who had moved, right, and Brit and West Indians who had moved to the United States and forcibly march them back into Canada to serve. The last thing I want to say, and that's my about the Canadians, is that the reasons cited for not wanting Black soldiers are of course comical, including my personal favorite: they would not look good in kilts. Because so many were in Highland units. One often overlooked way that African Americans had been engaging in this war physically and intellectually is that African Americans had been cutting across the Atlantic since 1914 as muleteers. The men working ships, mending, caring for the horses and mules that the British and the French were buying by the hundreds of thousands. So New Orleans and Newport News, Virginia were awash in Black people, Southerners in particular, who had not only been keenly aware of this war, but had navigated these submarine-infested waters back and forth throughout the months. And there's a great case of a sinking that I don't have time to talk about right now, but again, I spent the summer writing about it. And there's something weird for all of us who are historians. You know, when you find a great story, you're so excited, and it seems wrong, but you're like, I found a sinking, 200 people died, this is gonna be great, right? And then you're like, oops. but I was definitely that happy. Now, of course, the punitive war, right? That's what war meant to African Americans before we turned to Europe. And the quote under this political cartoon said, Uncle Sam, did you send the 8th Regiment of Illinois to the border to protect this country or to be shot down by Texans? Right? So you see them cowering behind. And so African Americans were seasoned soldiers. Right? And so, in fact, in the press, what you see are these constant references to having been in the War of Independence, even Carrizal, which is the most recent conflict, that they'd been in the Philippines, that there is no question of their, not only their patriotism, but their martial heroism. And so they found it quite insulting that it even took, that there was any public debate about it, but that it took so long for the Wilson administration to make some firm decisions. Going into the war, there were approximately 10,000 career soldiers and another 5,000 African Americans who were National Guardsmen. However, especially after the mutiny, as it was called, in Houston, the United States does the exact opposite of what would seem logical. Rather than take the men who had field experience, right, the very few American soldiers who had field experience, who even had some experience with the debacle called our aerial warfare in Mexico, rather than send them to France as the first wave, we in fact send them to the deep parts of the Philippines and the deep parts of Hawaii in order to quell this concern that if you taught Black men to shoot, the first thing they would do would be to turn those guns onto white people. Right? So for African Americans, this is an added insult because they feel as though they are in fact well positioned to serve their country. And in the case of the punitive expedition, Pershing had singled them out as his right-hand men, if you will. There had even been some attempts at informal integration during the punitive expedition. Not something to brag about, but Pershing had turned the other cheek when it came to integrated brothels in Mexico. He will swing to the total opposite when it comes to France. There were, for African Americans, also some heroes, right? Like here, Charles Young, a West Point graduate. For most, he seemed like the logical choice as a Black officer who could then lead, ideally African-American, but whoever else wanted to work with him, into battle. And of course, we know that the War Department would have none of it. They forcibly retire him. And one of the concessions that we get instead is this officer training camp in Fort Des Moines, Iowa, a location selected, the War Department said, because A, it was in the middle of nowhere, 400 acres landlocked in Iowa, that Iowa, because it had no people, had no racial tension, specious logic, and that because they were in the middle of nowhere, that would, in principle, also make it harder for white women to get to these men. So this officer training camp becomes the embodiment of that hope and promise for African Americans in 1917. What's important for us to also remember here is that it's not just soldiers. This is also a camp where nearly 1,000 African-American medical professionals are being trained and hoping for a commission, though none will get to be in, of the medical corps, will be in charge of Black troops. Now, Jim Crow requires commitment and resources. So, this is a photograph of African-American dentists who are being prepared to send over to France. When you're talking about a country that has only 478 Black dentists for 10 million people, the impact of a single loss is felt greatly on that community. In the 50 years of Howard University's existence, it had graduated roughly 4,500 people and half of all of the doctors in the country. Howard was the university that sent the most medical doctors into this war, nearly 20%. So the impact on the cost for African Americans is great, and for them then is a measure of their commitment and contribution to the nation. So black fraternities, historically black colleges and universities, are the first to respond to this call to war, and in particular this culling of the nation for officers. But women, of course, respond as well. And while the Red Cross initially banned black women, once the influenza outbreak begins, and it begins earlier in the United States, they realize they are going to need help. And so they finally admit 2,000, or they ask for 2,000 black women. As with white women, these were not just nurses, but they were also, as part of that talented 10th, that rare educated crust of American society, these were women who spoke French, who spoke German, and therefore were also translators, cultural conduits, and far more important given their small numbers. In the end, the Red Cross will have 16 black nurses in France for 50,000 soldiers. So what we get as our starting point for 1917 is a replication of a chiaroscuro nation, carefully crafted since Jim Crow, replicated overseas, black, white, and not necessarily together. Even the hostess huts or hostess houses that the YMCA set up overseas were separated by race. We have here again a photograph of black women who were at that officer training camp in Iowa. And here we have Motor Corps women who are driving around helping wounded soldiers as they find them. We know that there was a lot of concern about what to do with these black men socially, right? Because if nothing else, the women are white in France and the French are looser in every kind of way. So we have a lot of these photographs reassuring Americans that the disruption, the language they used at the time is, we can't let the French ruin our Negroes. But it's actually very large, this concern about a ruin, because it's about a sexual ruin. It's about an ideological or political ruin. They're especially concerned in 1917 that communists will get to the black soldiers, especially disgruntled Russians who are still stuck in France, and that they will start having all of these ideas. We know that during the East St. Louis riots, there's also a concern of not just Germans, but also Japanese and Mexican getting into African-American minds. Why are we concerned about the ruin of our black people? It's in part because they're on the move. They are voting with their feet, right? By leaving regions where it is no longer feasible to maintain a healthy lifestyle. So we always think of this great migration as being forced by a panic over racial violence, and of course that's true. But it's also because boll weevil and floods and other types of the collapse of cotton prices have made a barely sustainable life altogether impossible. And the army's pay of $30 a month, will in cash no less, will be a very seductive, will have its own seductive appeal for people leaving the region. But for all the panic, it's important to remember that only about 5% of African Americans left the South in 1916. So African Americans are still largely Southern rural farmers, even into World War I. In fact, this army's ability to pay in cash will be a reason why, cited for why African Americans could not be excused from service. They'll say, the $30 you'll make with us is more than you would have made cotton farming, so even if you have dependents, you still have to go and do your bit for the nation. However, sorry, I skipped a page here. So here I wanted you to remember that the way that African Americans move will be determined by the pre-existing networks and paths available to them. So the Mississippi and steamship is still the cheapest way to get out of the South. Rail lines and actual roads, so there are several rail lines that go along that yellow vector that you see there. And this is in part what speeds up that migration and the ability then to get that money in your pocket and buy a ticket for the first time. So this wonderful painting really captures that promise that we're talking about. It's children, it's old people, it's people in top hats, and it's people with, you know, a rag on their head, as with the woman through the Chicago door on the left. So it's really an opportunity for African Americans, like Europeans who were coming here, to follow their dream through a migrant experience. However, 1917 is also a year of extreme violence. And these are just five locations where we have race riots between May and late fall of 1917. So precisely as we are asking African Americans to die for their country, they're being killed in their country. The one that is best known, of course, is East St. Louis. It's written about as a labor dispute that unions had been opposing or calling attention to the fact that African Americans were being brought in as strike breakers. They respond violently, and this is what happens. But in truth, it's much more complicated than that. And what's more disturbing is the role that women and children, white women and children, had in particular during the East St. Louis crises. And the accounts of, you know, ripping people's hair out and hitting them with frying pans and so on. It really indicates the level of vitriol. It is estimated that 1,500 African Americans sped out of the region just during the early days of this race riot. And the response by both the local press and to a certain extent, the government, the response of saying that this is, you know, if African Americans fought back, it's really because the Germans were whispering in their ears, right? That it isn't something that they would have done all by themselves. They've always been happy with their oppression, if they had an opinion at all. But the thing is that this, I argue that this turn to a German or Japanese or Mexican plot actually allows for greater surveillance of African Americans, especially African American intellectuals, under the Espionage Act. Because unless it's the work of an enemy, then, you know, there's not as great of an urgency. So this is also a period then for African Americans where there's a heightened surveillance of their talented 10th, their most educated, their most vocal, their most politically elited. And this, you know, it is said of Hoover that he cut his teeth keeping track of and trying to silence these African Americans. But they're no fools. They quickly adopt alternative ways of making themselves heard. And this is the silent parade that we get in 1917. Now, emphasis here on the word parade. They deliberately do not call it a march so as to ensure that it is a patriotic act and not a protest. It is a celebration of what is right. That is, the first blood for American independence was shed by a Negro Crispus Attucks. A reminder in the various signage that we see in this long march up Fifth Avenue in New York of the politics of respectability, right? These are church women, children, they're wearing white, the color of mourning, but also a color of protection, so that if shot, if stabbed, you could see it well on the photographs, a strategy that is continued through the civil rights movement of the 1950s. As with other parts of society, African American children are mobilized in support of this war. And so here we get a newsboy who is selling war bonds, and judging by his missing front teeth, he's about 6 or so years old, right? So again, a reminder of how young it is, but we have posters, poems, recipes, again, reminders of how black women could stretch a dime into a dollar with respect to their food during the war, all of the work that's needed, and by the same measure, all of the support from those communities that we ask of other Americans. The Committee for Public Information, CPI, run by George Creel, even develops a Negro section for its propaganda and has black four-minute men, has black films, black posters, postcards, like this one here, but meant to make African Americans feel as though they are part of an important moment. So, Douce France, my next to last point, France, this utopian space. 89% of African Americans who went over to France did so as laborers and stevedores in particular. So when you got to France, whether you're an American or other allied forces, what you saw in these dock cities were all black people manning them. So Brest in the north has about 40,000 African Americans. Saint-Nazaire, a tiny, tiny town on the western coast that today, if you go, there's a huge Cargill depot. They've adopted the footprint that the Americans had. And Bordeaux become these contested terrains where we have early race riots as a result of these encounters on the docks. These are not soft pawed men, right? And they're not even just African Americans. In the United States, in the case of Philadelphia, for example, 50% of longshoremen were actually Jamaican. In the case of Miami, they control the union, and they're Bahamian. So these are the same men who are coming over under the American army and working those docks. These posters, these images, are in stark contrast to these kinds of colorful magazines that, again, are targeted at African Americans, but children in particular, are prideful soldiers, beautifully healthy-looking and manly. This CPI poster produced in 1918, but note here that the African-American soldiers are both keeping the Germans at bay and actually killing them in the dead center near the flag, and nobody's wearing overalls or lifting a crate, right? So this disjunction between the propaganda and what African-Americans are actually doing is very complicated, and the press, the black press, certainly addresses it. So when these African Americans, and I'm almost done, arrive in France, what do they encounter? Well, they encounter a continent that has spent a lot of the war thinking about fighting over race, including, so this one was a postcard, and it says, that's what they call a savage over here. Voilà ce que c'est un sauvage. So this idea that African Americans came to a France that welcomed them and was happy to see them and had no particular attachment to race is nonsense, because the French had been using their own tropes to both encourage black enlistment and also denigrate their German enemies. The Americans will arrive in the aftermath of the disastrous Nivelle Offensive of 1917, and where the tirailleurs suffered very high losses, and this idea, championed by General Charles Mangin here on the right, this idea that France's secret is its black force, its black power, the ability to call up an almost inexhaustible number of black people from the colonies who would be thrilled to do their part for the empire. It's the least that they could do as a thank you gift for France's civilizing mission and the gift of language and religion. This is what Mangin actually said. But should his paternalistic pablum prove unsatisfying, he then told Africans that they had a blood oath to France, and it was their turn to step up for a collective bloodletting. And in fact, Georges Clemenceau, probably my favorite character of the entire war, said that he would rather see 10 black men dead to one Frenchman. And by 1917, that is the French response. Not singularly to have black people killed, but in truth, the French are like, a black body will stop a bullet as well as anybody else's. So we're not that particular. And while we're happy to have the Americans come, we've been waiting for a long time for them to come, they can catch a bullet as well as anybody else as well, right? So we're happy that you're healthy. Get in there, right? But it's not some deep passion for Americans per se. At the civilian level, we hear much more of this, but we also have plenty of examples of an exploitation of Americans as kind of green, right? So there are a lot of reports of overcharging black people for food. The Germans had also been very crafty and proven themselves capable of manipulating a race card in this war, pointing out that black people were cannibals, and that's what they were ultimately gonna do if put it on the Western Front, that they were barbaric as warring peoples, and turning this language of lynching back onto Americans and saying, why are you fighting for these people? They lynch people who look like you. We do not. You should join our side. So there are already all of these debates about race in Europe long before the African Americans get there. And when they do, they fall into some immediately predictable stereotypes as the happy music playing people, right? So here we have James Reese Europe, who is sent almost immediately on a 25-city tour to play for sometimes European dignitaries, but oftentimes for just people who are in a hospital and are sick. And again, in this competition of race, the Canadians quickly put a black band together and send them on a tour as well. They're like, we can do this, we can do this. So, you know, we have a lot of these pictures of African Americans with instruments, rarely with actual weapons of war, which becomes an easy way to make light of their contributions. Not just because fewer saw combat, but the work that they did overseas, the overwhelming majority who were in labor battalions, did women's work, blue-collar work, right? Cooking, cleaning, digging toilets. Cleaning toilets. And so that's not the stuff that gets you a vote, and that's certainly not the stuff that you can lean on after the war in order to be taken more seriously as a citizen. I will end here with the pictures of Captain Stuart Alexander and Lieutenant Frank Robinson, who were just two of many African Americans who earned the Croix de Guerre, the French bravery for the French decoration for bravery in battle. And these croix de guerre that you see on these men and the cordons that they also sometimes have on their shoulders will become, for African Americans, another powerful measure of a failed possibility in 1917, that the French recognized what the Americans were all too ready to hang on a tree or light ablaze. And that, for many, will be the real shame, the real loss of the war. Now, I promised at the beginning that I would talk about the cost of war for African Americans, and so how timely that I am on my last slide, just as Laura is coming down. I want to end with the dysgenic impact of war. Now, dysgenic usually just means, in a narrow way, like the gene loss that we get. But here, there's a broader cultural impact as well. For one thing, the war halts civil rights campaigns. Those things I started with, the money sent to support legal cases, legal challenges to Jim Crow cars, Jim Crow restaurants, unequal pay for black teachers. Instead, that gets redirected towards suiting these guys up for war, making sure they have the socks that they need, the candy that they need, the care packages they need, the right kind of rifle, the right things to keep them warm, the right things to keep them happy. It is a strain on already limited and meager resources, both in terms of income, but also food. We're talking about people who barely had any food to begin with, to ration still more because of the war. It is a dramatic loss of that talented 10th. Right, that generation to have made it through school, to have sat through HBCUs, to have graduated from medical schools, to have graduated from law schools, the people, the professionals that we need in order to keep up the fight against Jim Crow, those with the know-how are left in Europe. It's a tremendous loss of medical professionals that we cannot afford and that will take entirely too long to replace. It leads to a greater police surveillance of African American communities, especially in the North, and that will slow civil rights like nothing else. And of course, the war era gives us an absolute spike in lynching and race riots and those arson attacks that I talked about. such that it will become the main thing that consumes African Americans between 1917 and 1920. So there's a tremendous amount of promise for African Americans in 1917, and that is what they carry when they cross the Atlantic. You'll have to come back next year to find out what happens afterwards. Thank you.
We have just a short amount of time for a question.
You had a couple of references to Pershing, but given his history of leading black troops all the way back to the Spanish-American War, what can you say about it, and did he acquiesce, or did he what were his views?
Oh, Pershing, what a mess. His experience with African-American soldiers even predates the Spanish-American War. He was, you know, involved with the Buffalo Soldiers in the Indian Wars and the Border Wars, even before the Philippines and Cuba. He has a mixed experience. On the one hand, his white peers mock him by initially calling him Nigger Jack. Then it gets cleaned up to Black Jack Pershing. But I have read this man's biographies. I've read more than I ever cared to, and he never expresses any particular affinity for black soldiers. Neither is he concerned or disdainful of them. But when it comes to World War I, he is obsessed with having a perfect army in effect, no matter the cost, right? And so black dots are not a part of it. And I think that his willingness to send black combatant troops to the French really solves, it's an easy solution to his problem. If they fail, as he expects that they will, then it's all the way over here and no one will write about it and talk about it. So, you know, it's over, the experiment is finished. So we can go back and say to the African Americans that we can't have an integrated army, you guys sucked, right? If they succeed, which they do, then it's all the way over in France, and with censorship, well, the news never quite made it over. So it's a convenient solution. He gives the French what they want, which is American soldiers that they can control and that they can train, but he has no particular regard for them, certainly by World War I.
I know that there are more questions in this auditorium. The pleasure of being in the room where it happens is, thank you for that one, laugh on that one. You're going to have the opportunity during our break, potentially, to ask those questions. I would also encourage you, most of your name tags have two tickets in there, to use those or offer one of those in a conversation with Dr. Mathieu as you ask her those questions.
Oh, Laura, you think I sell for cheap.
This is why you don't want to be watching it on TV or online. You want to be here in person. Please join me in thanking Dr. Saje Mathieu.
Thank you.